A very good morning. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with Breakfast News. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines of this morning. India reacts sharply to China's move to block Jaish terrorist Masood Azhar's blacklisting by UN, terms it short-sighted, counterproductive. Two army men killed and CRPF jawan injured in encounter in Pulwama in South Kashmir. Security forces gunned down one militant. Death toll in NTPC boiler blast in Raebareli at 29. Centre forms probe committee. Opposition demands judicial probe. Prime Minister to inaugurate World Food India 2017 in Delhi. 200 companies from 30 countries to participate. Focus on food processing sector. And in sports, Kidambi Srikanth secures world number 2 badminton ranking. Women's team to face Japan in Asia Cup hockey semi-final. Gagan Narang wins silver at Commonwealth Shooting Championships. India has reacted strongly to China's move to block Jaish terrorist Masood Azhar's being blacklisted by the United Nations. The Ministry of External Affairs said, and I quote, accommodating with terrorism for narrow objectives was short-sighted and counterproductive. India strongly believes that double standards and selective approaches will only undermine the international community's resolve to combat terrorism. Unquote. China's three-month technical hold on a proposal by the US, France and Britain was to lapse on Thursday, and the country again blocked a fresh proposal, citing absence of consensus among member countries to declare him an international terrorist. Last year, in March, China was the only member in the 15-nation UN Security Council to block India's application against Masood Azhar. India, backed by the United States, France and UK, has been trying to get Masood Azhar added to the UN list of groups with ties to Al-Qaeda. Masood Azhar's group, Jaish-e-Mohammed, is responsible for a series of deadly attacks in India, including the Uri attack in Kashmir last year, in which 17 security personnel were killed. While Jaish-e-Mohammed has already been blacklisted by the 15-nation Security Council, its chief Masood Azhar has not. Kenneth Juster will be the next U.S. ambassador to India. Juster's appointment was unanimously confirmed by the Senate on Thursday by a voice vote. The post has been lying vacant since January after Richard Verma resigned from the post in January before President Donald Trump's inauguration. 62-year-old Juster is an expert in India-U.S. relations and has played a key role in the landmark Indo-U.S. civil nuclear deal. He has over 35 years of experience as a senior business executive, senior law partner and senior government official, including serving as the U.S. Under Secretary of Commerce from 2001 to 2005. On to some more news. Two army men have been killed and a CRPF jawan suffered injuries during an encounter in Pulwama in South Kashmir. The security forces gunned down a militant in the encounter at Sambura in Pulwama. Security forces launched a cordon and search operation in Sambura village of Pampor area on Thursday evening, following information about the presence of some militants there. During the search operation, militants opened fire, leading to a gun battle. A BSF jawan was killed by firing from the Pakistani Rangers in Jammu and Kashmir's Samba district on Thursday. The Rangers attacked a BSF patrol party along the international border, firing indiscriminately at the jawans. Indian troops guarding the border retaliated, and the exchange of fire lasted for some time. In another attack, terrorists targeted a CRPF vehicle in Anantnag district. Terrorists opened fire on the vehicle of the 96th Battalion CRPF in Lazibal in Anantnag district. Five jawans were injured in the attack. A BJP youth leader was killed by militants in South Kashmir's Shopian on Thursday. The body of Gohar Hussain Bhatt was recovered from an orchard. He He was a resident of Bongam area in Shopian. The police have registered a case and investigations are on. Bhatt was the district president of BJP's youth wing and was associated with the party for over 2 years. BJP President Amit Shah condoled the Bhatt's death. And on to election news. With exactly a week to go for Himachal polls, campaigning in the state has intensified. Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed two rallies in the poll-bound state on Thursday. He attacked the ruling Congress government in Himachal Pradesh, saying Chief Minister Veerbhadra Singh was taking off action against corruption when he himself was out on bail in a corruption case.
Campaigning for the BJP in poll-bound Himachal Pradesh, Prime Minister Narendra Modi launched a scathing attack on the ruling Congress party. Modi said the Congress has become a laughing club for promising to act tough on corruption at a time when one of its chief ministers is facing graft charges.
Congress party chunav manifesto mein ye likhe aur swayam mukhyamantri ji jo zamanat pe hain bhrashtachar par case chal raha hai.
Addressing a rally in Kangra district, the Prime Minister said that state after state had rejected the Congress, indicating that it was time for Himachal to do the same.
Devbhoomi mein ye dusri danviya pravruti hai, bond mafia, ek khanan mafia, dusra van mafia. एक भू संपदा को लूटता है, दूसरा वन संपदा को लूटता है, तीसरा माफिया जो आपके घर में आकर के आपके भविष्य को लूटता है, आपके सपनों को लूटता है, आपके संस्कारों को लूटता है, और वो है हमारी युवा पीढ़ी को तबाह करने वाले, हमारी युवा पीढ़ी को बर्बाद करने वाले ड्रग माफिया.
The Prime Minister also targeted Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi for meeting the Chinese ambassador during the standoff in Doklam earlier this year.
भारत की संसद में 12-15 साल से बैठा हुआ कोई व्यक्ति जिसके परिवार के लोग पिता प्रधानमंत्री रहे हो, दादी प्रधानमंत्री रही हो, नाना प्रधानमंत्री रहे हो, जन्म से जिनको राज परिवार में पलने बढ़ने का अवसर मिला हो, वो देश पे भरोसा न करे, सरकार पे भरोसा न करे, सेना पे भरोसा न करे, और चीन के राजदूत से मिलकर के पूछे कि डोकलाम में क्या चल रहा है.
In his speech, the Prime Minister also sought to strike a chord with women voters and families of defence personnel. Voting for 68 assembly seats in Himachal Pradesh will take place on the 9th of November. Votes will be counted on the 18th of December. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Meanwhile, Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday visited the iconic Akshardham Temple in Gandhinagar to attend an event to mark the 25 years of its existence. In a series of tweets, he said he remembered Pramukh Swamiji Maharaj, the guru and the head of Swami Narayan Sanstha, an international socio-spiritual organization. The Prime Minister did not speak much about politics, but made a reference to the agitation by the Patels for quotas. The Swami Narayan Sanstha has a huge Patel following.
संदेश आधुनिक टेक्नोलॉजी थी, आवनार मुलाकाती, आवे तेरे भक्त नहीं होतो, पर जाए तेरे भक्त बनी ले जाए, स्थिति पैदा करी. आधुनिकता अनेक दिव्यता बनने नो सुभग संयोग। एज रीते तमे अक्षरधाम मंदिर क्यांय पण जाओ तो प्रत्येक पत्थर बोलतो होय छे।
And Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi resumed his election campaign in poll-bound Gujarat Thursday. Addressing a rally in Valsad District's Nana Ponda, Gandhi said that the fight between the party and the BJP in Gujarat was one between truth and lies. Attacking the centre on economic issues, Gandhi said that Prime Minister has failed in providing jobs to the youth. He also targeted the government over the black money issue.
BJP ka sach hai. उसे गुजरात के सच से कुछ लेना देना नहीं। गुजरात का सच गुजरात के नौजवानों की बेरोजगारी है। गुजरात का सच गुजरात के किसानों का दर्द और लाचारी है।
And on to the news from Uttar Pradesh, death toll in the NTPC boiler blast in Raebareli has risen to 29 after 9 more people died during treatment on Thursday. 85 people are being treated for burn injuries. The centre has formed a 3-member committee headed by Executive Director of NTPC to probe the accident. The committee has to submit its report within 30 days, looking into all aspects of design, installation and maintenance to ascertain the cause. Uttar Pradesh administration has also ordered a magisterial inquiry. Meanwhile, the National Human Rights Commission has issued a notice to the UP government over the blast, demanding a detailed report within 6 weeks. The Congress and the Samajwadi Party have demanded a judicial probe into the incident.
कारणों को जानने के लिए हमने एक एक्सपर्ट कमेटी का गठन किया। 3 मेंबर की कमेटी है, उसमें हमारे वरिष्ठ जो डायरेक्टर है श्री एसके राय जी, उसको ये कमेटी के चेयरमैन रहेंगे, और एक इंजीनियरिंग के एक्सपर्ट है और एक ऑपरेशन के एक्सपर्ट है, और ये 30 दिन में ये कमेटी रिपोर्ट देगी, और जो भी हमारे पास तथ्य सामने आएंगे उसके बाद इसको जो आवश्यक कार्रवाई होगी हम किया जाएगा, और जो कमी है उसको सुधारा जाएगा।
The Supreme Court will today hear a petition challenging the constitutional validity of the Aadhaar Act. The petitioner from Karnataka moved the top court saying that Aadhaar Act infringes upon the right of privacy and the biometric mechanism was not working properly. On October 30th, a bench headed by Chief Justice Deepak Mishra had said that a constitution bench would be constituted and Aadhaar-related matters would come up for hearing before it in the last week of November. Several petitions challenging the centre's move to make Aadhaar card mandatory for availing various services and benefits of the government welfare schemes have been filed in the Apex Court. The Supreme Court commenced hearing on a batch of petitions filed by the Delhi government on its administrative powers. The hearing is to determine whether the elected government in Delhi or the Lieutenant Governor enjoys supremacy in administration. The court, in its observation, said that Article 239A of the Constitution is unique with respect to Delhi. It said, prima facie, it appears that the Lieutenant Governor is given more powers in Delhi unlike other union territories. The Delhi government is challenging the High Court's verdict that Delhi is not a state and that LG is its administrative head. The Aam Aadmi Party government told the Apex Court that bureaucrats do not acknowledge ministers as the heads of the departments. A 5-judge constitution bench of the Supreme Court is hearing these petitions. Moving on, Chennai witnessed massive water logging as heavy rains continue to pound the Tamil Nadu capital on Thursday. Schools, colleges and private offices in Chennai and adjoining Kanchipuram have declared holiday today due to bad weather. 3 more districts in Tamil Nadu, including Tiruvallur, Nagapattinam and Karaikal in Puducherry, have announced that schools will be closed today. More rains is expected in parts of state for the next 24 hours as the low pressure in Southwest Bay and adjoining Sri Lanka persists. And with that, time for a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
Jade was popular during Mughal era and gained prominence during Akbar's rule in 15th and 16th century. It
came all the way from Iran and Central Asia in attractive colors. The royalty had a unique use for it. Since jade changed color when it came in contact with arsenic, they started utensils like plates, jars, bowls, and even hookah with it, and thereby avoided getting poisoned by rivals. Thanks for being with us. So World Food India 2017, a three-day event that will see the biggest coming together of global investors and business leaders of major food companies is being held in Delhi. Prime Minister Narendra Modi is at Vigyan Bhavan to inaugurate the event. The event aims to transform food economy and realize the vision of doubling the farmers' income. The event aims to establish India as a preferred investment destination and sourcing hub for the global food processing industry. This is the first time that India is hosting such an event for the food processing sector. Over 2,000 participants and 200 companies from around 30 countries are participating in the event. Japan is being represented by 60 companies. Apart from 28 states, 18 ministerial and business delegations, nearly 50 global CEOs along with CEOs of the leading domestic food processing companies are participating. Germany, Japan and Denmark are partner countries for the event. Italy and the Netherlands are the focus countries. An exhibition spread over 40,000 square meters at the India Gate lawns will be the major attraction.
Have also opened up huge investment opportunities in the food processing sector. With 127 agro-climatic zones, there is perhaps nothing under the sun that India can't grow. India has a vast production base with 514 million metric tons of agri-horticulture products. It is the largest producer of milk in the world, the second largest producer of cereals, fruits and vegetables, and the second largest producer of seafood and fisheries. India is also the leading consumer of food in the world, with a population of 1.3 billion.
We are playing you the visuals of World Food India Conference 2017, which is being organized in Delhi. This is a three-day event, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi is at Vigyan Bhavan, where the event is taking place. He is there to inaugurate the event. Meanwhile, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu inaugurated the Aero Expo on Thursday. Vice President Naidu said that the most crucial aspects in the aviation industry that needs special attention are safety and security. He stressed that there cannot be any compromise on these two counts, and the most stringent norms have to be adopted for ensuring safe and secure air travel.
Inaugurating the second Aero Expo India 2017, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu termed the aviation sector the backbone of the global transport system. He noted that global statistics over the last 5 years show a decrease both in the number of accidents as well as the accident rate. The Vice President, however, cautioned that there cannot be any complacency and safety should remain the topmost priority of aviation authorities and experts.
In 2016, the downward trend continued with 75 accidents reported, representing an 18% decrease from 15. It's no matter of satisfaction, we should drastically bring down and we should see to it there are no accidents at all.
Vice President Naidu also asserted that with increasing disposable income and a growing middle class, air travel will see a further spurt. Hailing the Udaan scheme for regional connectivity, he underscored the need for developing no-frills and greenfield airports, augmenting existing capacities and creating synergy between scheduled and non-scheduled airlines.
Augmenting existing capacities, creating synergy between scheduled and non-scheduled airlines for better penetration and connectivity through collaborative efforts of the state and central government is needed.
India became the world's fastest growing domestic travel market for the 22nd time in a row, recording a 26.6% year-on-year growth in January 2017. India is witnessing a high growth trajectory and is set to become the third largest aviation market in the world in terms of passenger by 2026. It also replaced Japan to become the largest domestic aviation market globally.
Domestic traffic in India is growing at around 20% annually, while international traffic is increasing at 10%. The Indian aviation sector provides direct employment to more than 2 lakh people and lakhs of indirect jobs. The Economic Survey of 2016-17 called civil aviation in India a potential sunrise sector for growth and employment generation. Reporting from Delhi, with camera person Anirban, I'm Kruti Mishra for Rajya Sabha Television.
And the Rajya Sabha's Secretariat Club organized a cultural event on Thursday. The event was attended by Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu and Secretary General Desh Deepak Verma, among other officers of the Secretariat. The cultural event saw an enchanting performance by folk singer Malini Awasthi.
किसी परिचय के मोहताज मालिनी अवस्थी नहीं है, इसलिए मैं सीधे उनका स्वागत करना चाहूंगी, पद्मश्री मालिनी अवस्थी जी।
Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu attended a cultural program at the Rajya Sabha Secretariat Club in the Parliament premises. Folk singer Malini Awasthi's mesmerizing performance at the event left the audience spellbound. Speaking at the event, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu underscored the need to preserve our cultural heritage.
Ram Rajya mane koi mazhab ka rajya nahi hai. Ram ji bharatiya samskruti ka ek prateek hai. Is a cultural identity of this nation. We should all feel proud and we should not get into this religious things and all. That you will continue to contribute.
Vice President Naidu explained the importance of the Upper House of Parliament on the occasion.
Let us make an assessment of the areas where improvement can be made, both in terms of functioning of the House and Secretariat. Identify the areas which will require focused attention. I am sure with the support and cooperation of all of you, we will find enduring solutions to all our concerns.
Rajya Sabha Secretary General Desh Deepak Verma also addressed the officers and workers of the Secretariat at the event.
We have the glimpse of your vision of what the Rajya Sabha Secretariat and the Rajya Sabha should do. I assure you, sir, that this Secretariat, with its very good set of officers and employees, will always be in the forefront to assist you in your vision.
The Rajya Sabha Secretariat promotes cultural pursuits through such events and competitions every year. Navikram Singh's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Armenia's president Serge Sargsyan is in Delhi on a 3-day visit. Sargsyan arrived in Delhi on Thursday. He will meet the prime minister and a call by the vice president M. Venkaiah Naidu. He will also meet President Ramnath Kovind at Rashtrapati Bhavan. He will visit Agra on November 4th before leaving for his country. Also, Latvian prime minister Maris Kuczynski is on a 5-day visit to India. He will meet Prime Minister Narendra Modi today. He will also call on President Ramnath Kovind at Rashtrapati Bhavan. Visit to Mumbai is also on his itinerary. Both the leaders are participating in the opening ceremony of the World Food India 2017 conference. And shifting our focus onto the international front, New York City reopened the bike path on Thursday, where 8 people were killed after a truck drove directly into the cyclist 2 days earlier. People laid flowers and balloons at the makeshift memorial and gathered to say prayers. In Washington, members of the House of Representatives observed a moment of silence in honor of the 8 people killed. Details that emerged at Saifullo Saipov's initial court appearance paint a picture of a man who had planned even more carnage after the deadly attack on a bike path in Lower Manhattan. However, the 29-year-old Uzbek native was shot by the police immediately after the attack and was put in custody. Meanwhile, US President Donald Trump called for a death penalty for the suspect, describing the man as a terrorist. So far, IS Group has not claimed the responsibility for the attack, despite the attacker declaring he was inspired by the jihadist group. Tuesday's assault was the deadliest in New York City since 9/11 attack on World Trade Center. Update on Catalonia crisis. 8 former ministers from Catalonia's dissolved government have been jailed after Spain's High Court order. The state prosecutor also sought a Europe-wide arrest warrant for ousted leader Carles Puigdemont. The High Court had summoned Puigdemont and former ministers over their contentious independence drive, but only 9 of them turned up at the session without Puigdemont. The judge ordered the 8 be remanded in custody, while the 9th was granted bail. Puigdemont and the other 4 ministers are believed to still be in the Belgian capital. The Catalan crisis came to a head last week when the Catalan parliament declared unilateral independence. In response, Madrid sacked Puigdemont and his government and stripped Catalonia of its cherished autonomy. Meanwhile, thousands of Catalans protested against the detention of the 8 regional ministers. Puigdemont also called for the release of the Catalonia leaders.
Com a president del govern legítim de Catalunya, sorgit de les urnes del 27 de setembre, exigeixo l'alliberament dels consellers i conselleres i del vicepresident. Exigeixo el respecte a totes les opcions polítiques i exigeixo la fi de la repressió política.
Now on to some sports news. Ace Indian badminton player Kidambi Srikanth has achieved his career best ranking. He is world number 2. In the latest ranking published by the Badminton World Federation, Srikanth has been rewarded for this sensational run this season after jumping 2 places. Srikanth has clinched 4 titles this year. He now has 73,403 points, just 4,527 points away from world champion Victor Axelsen of Denmark. And India will face Japan in the semi-final match of the Women's Asia Cup Hockey in Kawasaki Stadium in Japan today. On Thursday, India defeated Kazakhstan to enter the semi-final stage. India beat Kazakhstan 7-1. For India, Gurjeet Kaur scored 3 goals, while Navneet Kaur scored twice and Deep Grace converted 2 penalty corners to ensure victory. Earlier, Indian women's team beat China 4-1. The team also beat Singapore by a huge margin of 10-1. Ace Indian shooter Gagan Narang has clinched the silver medal in the 50-meter rifle prone competition at the Commonwealth Shooting Championships in Brisbane. Narang scored 617.6 to claim the medal. Among other Indians, Swapnil Suresh bagged the bronze in the same event. While in women's 25-meter pistol, Surat Singh won the bronze. On Wednesday, India claimed 5 medals, including 2 gold. Ace Indian boxer Marie Kom and Shiksha have advanced to the quarterfinals of the Asian Women's Boxing Championship in Vietnam. Olympic bronze medalist Marie Kom defeated Vietnamese Diem Thiem Kieu in the opening round of the light flyweight 48 kilograms category. Marie Kom will now face Chinese Taipei's Ming Xiangping. While debutant, Shiksha defeated Mongolia's Oyogzin Ardini in the 54 kilograms category. She will now face Firangiz Koshimova. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.